to everyone for coming to a full room with glaring lights, so hopefully you have this to be able to wear through the next hour. My name is Bart. I serve as advisor on global affairs at the European Commission's in-house think tank called the European Political Strategy Center. And I'm delighted to moderate this panel. We couldn't have had better panelists with us. And we'll kick it off from my immediate right down the line. Let me first introduce the panelists, some of you, whom may be well known to you already, but just quick background bios for your context. First, we have Minister Péter Szijjártó from Hungary. He served as Minister of Foreign Affairs since 2014 and has been a member of parliament since 2002, so has very extensive experience on these issues. Next, we have Maciej Popowski, currently the Deputy Director General of DG NEAR at the European Commission, but also what one might term as the Dean of Polish Diplomacy in Brussels, having been in Brussels since 2001, and serving in very senior positions throughout this time. Next to his right is Dan Fried, with whom I had a chance to collaborate closely when we were both at the State Department between 2014 and 2017. Dan is now a distinguished fellow at the Atlantic Council, but is probably very well known to many of people in this room, having been ambassador to Poland, having served for 4 decades at the State Department, most recently as sanctions coordinator in the Obama administration, but previously as Assistant Secretary of State for European and Eurasian Affairs, and many other times as well that I bore you with. And last but not least, we have Dobran Božič from Slovenia, currently the Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs, and previously, I should say Major General Dobran Božič, because previously he served as the Chief of Staff of the Slovenian Armed Forces. So, as you can see, a broad range of experience and perspectives on the panel. And the topic for the discussion is Western Balkans and its strategic significance both to Europe and to America, and sort of the path forward. I've asked the panelists to focus on several guiding questions, but I'm sure they'll say whatever they want to say in any event. But if you could, you know, from your vantage point, provide the state of play in the region, what's currently happening, what have been the most recent trends, sort of the near-term and medium-term expectations in the region. Second, and this might be sort of a relatively obvious question to ask, but it's probably not asked often enough. What are the, in your views, the main political, economic, and security interests that both either your respective countries or the EU at large or the US, in Dan's case, have in the region or specific parts of the region? Third, you know, this was brought up earlier at a panel this morning. Who are the competitors for transatlantic role, transatlantic influence in the region, maybe China and Russia, but exactly what is their role, and to what extent are they true competitors, what are their objectives in the region? Finally, given all that, what should the EU and the US pursue? What policies should be pursued? Obviously, enlargement and enlargement perspective is one issue that's raised relatively frequently, but beyond that, or in addition to that, what are the specific steps that individual countries on the EU or US side could do, or the transatlantic community put together? So with those brief introductory remarks, let me start with Mr. Szijjártó, and then we'll proceed down the line. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And thank you very much for the organizers to include me into this panel about the Western Balkans, which is definitely a part of the Hungarian foreign policy, not totally independent from the fact that we are in the neighborhood. So maybe we are a little bit more sensitive to all issues regarding the Western Balkans compared to some other countries who are far away from these areas. Well, it's obvious, and I don't have to explain it too long, I guess, that the European Union is faced with a tremendous and historic type of challenges. And the actually, there were no really good news recently that we spread around about Europe. And we need some good news. And I think that enlargement is the best and easiest instrument to spread around good news about the European Union. Actually, enlargement could be very easily made as a success story. Because what we are suffering now about is that the British are leaving. It's going to be a big loss. 14% of European economic performance, 1/7, biggest army, most successful and most effective secret service, security council member, nuclear power. So this make a long list. So it's going to be a loss that they are leaving. And it has never happened to the European Union that when the number of the member states has changed, it would have been a decrease, right? So it was always an increase. And we have to come back to this path. So enlargement would be a good, let's say, medicine in order to cure the wounds which will be caused by the British leaving. On the other hand, when it comes to economy, it would be a true European economic interest to integrate the Western Balkan countries. Why? Because the number one trading partners of all Western Balkan countries are member states of the European Union. So if we remove all the obstacles from the way, then and we would have absolutely free trade between the European Union member states and the Western Balkan countries, that would definitely bring economic benefits. Not to speak about security. We are faced with the phenomenon and challenge of illegal massive migration. Look, the more south we can push the defense side of ours, the better and the safer we are. We know it because we have to build a fence on our southern border in order to stop the illegal migratory flows. So the more southern we do have this defense line, is the better for us. And maybe this is not the most sophisticated sentence you ever hear from somebody who has never been a diplomat, but happens to be most of them, that the more we are, the stronger we are. So I think it's easy. I mean, we really need to enlarge. And what I want to tell you is that sometimes I'm really frustrated with that hypocrisy which is around the enlargement, especially when it comes to Western Balkans. We are gathered once a month, foreign ministers of the European Union. And whenever we discuss about the Western Balkans, everybody is crying, you know, saying that, oh, there are so many countries putting their pressure and influence on the Western Balkans. There are the Russians, the Turks, the Qataris, the Americans, the Moon, Jupiter, everybody. You know, everybody puts influence on the Western Balkans. My question is, so what prevents us from doing the same? Because these countries want to be members of the European Union and not another integration. And we, the European Union, should make the necessary step. Look, Montenegro, no bringing food, 600,000 people, opened all but one chapter. NATO members, paying with Europe. I mean, we don't pay with Europe. I pay with Europe. So, no danger. Why don't we accept them? Sure, you know, they have made a lot of reforms in order to be able to come to the European Union. We have to be aware of one thing. In this area of the world, or Europe, it's absolutely not natural and not given that the public is pro-European, or the public would be pro-Euro-Atlantic. Because there's a country like Serbia, which was born a couple of years ago by our allies. So it's not natural and not given that these countries, the public of these countries, would be absolutely pro-European, pro-Euro-Atlantic integration. And we have to maintain this situation. But in order to maintain this situation, we should help those governments which are pro-European and pro-Euro-Atlantic. So giving no positive feedback, lecturing them all the time, not opening chapters, opening just one negotiation chapter in a half year, not opening the last chapter with Montenegro, you know, that's a humiliation. And I don't understand why we are doing it. For us, 2025, as a goal, as a set date, is unacceptable. Is absolutely unacceptable. It's still 6 years to go. 6 years meaning 2,200 days. I mean, do we really need 2,200 days to understand that enlargement would be necessary? And do really the Montenegrins or Serbs or the others would need 2,200 days to be allowed to come to the European Union? So I think we should do it much quicker. We really should do it. And you know, on the last Gender Affairs Council meeting, I was very much frustrated again because before the Council, everybody was speaking about the necessity of enlargement. Everybody was speaking in favor of the North Macedonians and the Albanians. And then on the meeting, certain member states stood up and said no. You know, and this is something that we cannot accept, and that we shouldn't afford as a European Union. So enlargement should happen. Enlargement should not only be a communication balloon, and enlargement should happen basically tomorrow. And we really hope that there will be no more political revenge, and the next Hungarian or the current Hungarian candidate will be able to become the enlargement commissioner of the European Union. And I can promise you that now enlargement will be pushed forward and will be accelerated.
Great, thank you very much. If I could turn to Major General Božič to give your perspective on any of those issues that the minister covered, quite a broad range, but if you could offer us your perspective and, you know, maybe how you would respond to some of the objections from France or Holland, or, you know, procedures might say, well, you know, in our domestic politics, it doesn't play as well, and the case is not as clear, and so, you know, defined for the French or defined for the Dutch, clear European interest in the Balkans.
And thank you very much. Thank you for having me here. It's always hard to speak after the best speaker in the European Union, after the minister. So maybe as the minister pointed out today, the title is pretty okay. But tomorrow, if the enlargement is not here, probably we will speak the importance of the Western Balkans is both overlooked and ignored, both. So I hope that next year we won't talk about that. But let's go back in 1990s. I was young kid, and we had a referendum about the independence of Slovenia. And at that time, as a young person, and we had many millions of young persons in the region, in the Western Balkans, I didn't vote for independence of Slovenia, just for independence of Slovenia, of course, but I voted for European Union and NATO. And when we entered the European Union, another referendum, we said, we live in European Union, and we are still in NATO. And so I think we should bear in mind that there is a lot of young potential, and we all, it's our duty that we bring, you know, that young generation and give them better future. But just to go back about the geography, we are talking about the Western Balkans, and somebody will discuss it. It's not the right term. We are talking about the South and Eastern Europe, but whatever. For me, it's a strategic geographical point. Many security and stability issues happened in this area. The First World War, I wasn't there, sparked in Sarajevo. So we had that issue. So I know that, I read that the treaty, the surrender treaty, signed by General Ler in the Second World War, was signed in Slovenia, so again in that area. We had armed conflict in the 90s that influenced complete Europe. So it's really, and it's placed in the heart of Europe, we can say that, and it's critical for stability and security in the region. And by the way, that region that we are talking about, Western Balkans, whatever, is completely surrounded by European Union and NATO. And so it's vital for us that we move forward and that we are really, really bold. We can do probably many things. Slovenia, we advocate that we do, I must say that it's a swift merit-based enlargement process, which will finally consolidate complete Europe. That's our agenda, and it should, like Minister said, happen tomorrow. That's definitely it's our agenda. And our thinking. Also, we believe that the European Union, that we need stable Balkan area, and of course the Balkan area, then needs the European Union to be more prosperous. So it's a win-win situation if they're in the European Union and they follow the values. If we are ignoring the Western Balkans, the region, all the problems that there are, their problems, they won't disappear. Believe me, they will come back bigger and stronger, and we will face the problems in the near future, in 2025, believe me. We will have bigger and bigger problems there. We believe that we should be more active in the region, bringing them quicker into the integration process, but also we have to admit that also the region, they should do more fighting the corruption, fighting the fake news, do the rule of law. So it's both way, what they process. And I believe that if we are going that way, it is definitely a success story. At the end of the day, as my colleague, that he was the commander of NATO in NATO cell in Northern Macedonia, said, I can guarantee you with enlargement, NATO enlargement in Northern Macedonia, the region is more stable. It's definitely more stable, and I believe him, and I know that it's true. So, bringing the region into the European Union, it means more prosperity for the European Union and for the region. So it's really, I try to always convince all people that are against it, or they have some suspicions, they're not ready. Of course, we are never ready. Slovenia was probably not ready at that time when we entered the NATO and European Union. But entering that, we are much better now and with the process. And we have to listen. We have to listen the voice in the region. The voice is loud, clear, and they're screaming. We would like to go, and we would like to be part of the European Union family. And also for us, we should be proud that somebody is trying to get so hard in our integration, and it's not so bad. So it's a sign that it's not so bad, and people that are wanting to come to the European Union. And I will conclude here.
Thanks very much. One way to summarize what both of you said is, in the words of the European Commission President Juncker, Europe could either export stability to the Balkans or import instability from the Balkans. And yet, the time frame that you set out of tomorrow or maybe the day after is maybe ambitious for some other European partners. And Maciej, if I could turn to you, as a veteran of a lot of these discussions in Brussels and having worked extensively in the region over the past several years, if you could offer your take on these issues and also, you know, the path forward over the next several years.
Thank you, Bart. The advantage of the spotlight is that I can't read my notes, so I'll try to speak freely. Look, I will. On the state of play. But I am a byproduct of enlargement myself, so I always tend to compare the situation today to that of 15, 20 years ago. And the main difference is that there is this lack of the realization by the wider public of the historical importance of enlargement. That was the case around 2000. It's no longer the case today. And I know many said that we are frustrated by the discussions at the Council because we leave them daily. So our job in the Commission is to keep the machinery running, and we've been doing that. Luckily, Western Balkans and the region is clearly back on the agenda. That was clearly set out in the Western Balkans strategy of 2018. Nobody would put that into question. President Kalec von der Leyen also referred to Western Balkans in her first speech in Strasbourg in July, and I was there, and that's very reassuring. So we know the direction of travel is clear. But there are deep divisions in the European Union. So we keep the machinery running, but at the same time, we are performing a balance here, we as the engine room, the Commission. The further we go from the region, the less enthusiasm there is. I wish everybody was so motivated and enthusiastic as you are, Minister, but it's not the case. So, you know, we really have to work hard, and of course the countries in the region have to deliver. We need a good track record of reforms, we need reassurances on the judiciary, rule of law, economic reform, economic integration, and indeed sometimes there are good stories. And you know, what happened, the name deal, was of historical proportion. So we really hope that will be recognized by everybody. Because frankly speaking, it would be irresponsible not to recognize what has happened back in a few months ago. So our next intermediate objective is to get a positive decision on opening of the accession negotiations with North Macedonia and Albania in 2 weeks, the 16th of October. And it's not done deal yet. We are working on it. I think we have a good story to tell. Maybe some more question marks about Albania. They also have made a lot of progress when you look at the reform of the judiciary that's been ongoing for nearly 2 years. And indeed, Balkans matter to us, politically, security-wise, economically. Ideally, this is the making place. We are all around, and in fact, quite well integrated with the rest of Europe already. Integrating the Balkan countries as member states is not that demanding. I mean, it's 18 million people. I think we can manage that. And our initial thinking, I'm not revealing any secrets, but our initial thinking when drafting the strategy, and I was part of the drafting team, was to be very, very bold and to say, let's try to anticipate what's going to happen on the day of accession. So let's try to phase in structural support. Let's try to bring them on board in different council bodies. When we started consulting member states, not everybody was equally impressed, so we had to go down a bit on our level of ambition. But we are not giving up. I mean, I'm not going to summarize this most important strategy because everybody has read it, of course. But it's there, and I think it's a good roadmap. 2025 is there too. I mean, again, you know, we are ready to move as fast as our partners are, and then of course the member states need to be on board. On the risks are there. I'm dealing specifically with some security questions in the Balkans, with counter-terrorism, with growing radicalization in some countries. We have to take it seriously. So we are working very hard with the countries there, also with NATO and with other organizations to counter these risks, and also to use it as one of the arguments to move forward with enlargement. But we also have to counter certain narratives because some people have the impression that everything, every evil comes from the region. It's not true. Even if you count the number of foreign fighters in Syria or Iraq, okay, there were thousands from Western Balkan countries, there were 400 from Belgium. Put Popowski on there a bit. We, coming back to two guiding questions, the last ones on the competitors. We are not alone. NATO, of course, rocks the vacuum, so there's always a lot of operators in there. China, Russia, Turkey, Gulf countries. It's a challenge. They have different agendas. Sometimes, like in case of Chinese investment, our short-term objectives are basically the same. We want to invest in infrastructure. But the long-term objectives do not necessarily match. So when the Chinese come in, they come with commercial investment, and that also sometimes it causes more problems than it does solve. There was this case of a motorway built with a Chinese company and a Chinese loan in Montenegro that added 20% to the Montenegro public debt. We don't work that way. I can come back to that, but we are fully aware of that, and we know that we have to be more forceful also in maintaining the perspective. And finally, on the EU-US cooperation, I think we are pretty well aligned on the policy. I have to say that the personality in charge keep changing in Washington. But the last appointment of Matt Palmer as a special envoy was quite reassuring. He's a great professional and really an expert on the region. So when he was appointed, it was really good news for us. And I think also on the ground, when I talk to our ambassadors, their relationship with the U.S. colleagues on the ground is perfect. And also our leverage, our clout there is complementary. I think you are much more powerful and costable in terms of, you know, security, acting as a security provider. Economically, we are, of course, much, much closer also in terms of investment and pre-accession aid. So the region is certainly not overlooked and will certainly not be ignored. And so the new commission coming in, hopefully still on the 1st of November, will simply go ahead as well.
Great, thanks very much. And now, if I could turn before turning to your questions, for the close of Dan Free, to give us maybe the U.S. perspective, but particularly on what are the U.S. interests in the region, is it, and what are the, you know, to the extent that the Balkans are debated in Washington, how is the issue framed? Is it around great power competition with Russia and China? Is it Europe for free and peace and completing the some of the projects from the 1990s, or something else still?
as a foreign policy professional and ex-one,
I'll take whatever strategic argument gives me the political scaffolding for the right set of actions. And I define the right set of actions is, you know, in my terms, completing Europe whole, free, and at peace. But if you want to call it facing the reality of great power competition and keeping the Russians and Chinese not out, but their influence under control, I'll take that one too. And if it requires me to give full credit to the Trump administration for strategic insight and brilliance, I'll do that happily. If we get the United States working with the European Union to bring these countries into Europe, and so I'll start with Foreign Minister Szijjártó's point because I basically agree with him. Yeah, I mean, the timetable may be optimistic, but in any European debate, there's got to be somebody leading the charge from a position of high principle, and if Hungary wants to take up that role, good. That's the right thing to do. No, and I agree with the arguments. The second asset we have has been mentioned, but I'm gonna foot stomp that. The North Macedonia Greek deal is the best thing in the region in many years. Right. That is a big deal. The Greeks stared down their own nationalist constituency, and so did the Macedonian governments, you know, with Nikola Dimitrov really the architect of that one, but a new government. This is solid stuff. And the argument for further steps and a response from the EU in terms of enlargement is really a kind of moral imperative at this point. The EU accession process provides a certain degree of leverage. I want to use that leverage for maximum impact, to not use it to demonstrate that it was all some kind of, you know, moving of the goalposts would be devastating. So I hope the EU succeeds. I think I'm glad to have Hungary. If Hungary is leading the charge on it, that's great. I'm all for it. And I think Greece is now a potential partner in dealing with, you know, the big unfinished issues in the Balkans. Serbia is one. Okay, I say that because I can't think of a set of circumstances that fixes Bosnia-Herzegovina without Serbia having made a less ambiguous decision about its own fate. And if that, Greece may now be able to help, Hungary may be able to help, and the United States ought to focus on building relations with Serbia. Maybe we don't take a big public lead because of our role in the NATO campaign, but whatever is possible to do, we need to do. I'm not talking about a NATO track for Serbia, that's too much, but an EU track and helping Serbs make the political argument that their future is and ought to be with Europe. If Serbia moves, that makes dealing with Bosnia-Herzegovina a lot easier. That makes Montenegro a lot easier. That means that the Russian role of spoiler, manipulator, and possibly instigator of wars, and if you don't believe me, ask our Georgian and Ukrainian friends, it gives us assets to beat back those bad Russian instincts. And we can't do it simply by being angry or yelling at Moscow. We have to start creating facts on the ground, by which I mean positive facts. And we have to show people in the region, in the Balkans, that a future in a growing Europe and an undivided transatlantic community is the right future. Now, I know what you're thinking. You know, who am I as an American to talk about that when the Americans are giving contrary signals all the time? I get it. I know. You know, if I can inject a point about U.S. domestic politics, I've said to people that it reminds me of the founding fathers of the United States who set up a system that they themselves, some of them slave owners, found impossible to live up to,
as individuals. They set out a system that was better than they were capable of achieving. Does that mean that the system is wrong or that they were hypocrites? Well, the good news is they were hypocrites, and then American history is gradually living up to the ideals. So look, that's the best I can do at the moment at trying to think of the long view. In the meantime, the United States and Europe ought to be working together on this one. It would be, in terms of U.S.-Hungarian cooperation, like, that's great. The Balkans, all for it, and with Greece. I mean, the new government in Greece has an ideal position. They get to trash the old agreement in principle to say they're going to live by it. Yeah, fine. If that's their position, I'm okay with it. Matt Palmer is the right guy. His boss, Phil Reeker, the acting assistant secretary for Europe, knows the Balkans well. So you have the right people in place, and there's no, let us say, American political angle to this. So I think the United States is in a position to do the right thing and help out with Europe as Europe hopefully makes the right decision. Last point about China. China is not a spoiler, but the deal that China looked like it was offering a few years ago all over the world turns out to be a pretty lousy deal. I mean, the debt trap is just one example. I'm surprised. I mean, the Chinese ought to do better than replicating sort of the worst practices of 19th century European imperialists and mid-20th century American, the bad side of American corporations in Central America. Those are some negative examples. And if I were in Beijing, I would urge them to study the negative examples, particularly the reaction it generated, which we're still dealing with. We learned better not to offer debt traps and call it assistance. But we need to put the United States and Europe, especially the EU, but us working with them, need to get in the game here. And in short, I see the Balkans as an area of cooperation. And if we fail to cooperate, it doesn't matter what we want. We can ignore them, but their problems will indeed, as Juncker said, start coming to us.
Great. Thanks so much to all four of you. Now let me turn to the audience, and we'll collect a few questions and then turn back to the panel. Person in the second row. Mic swap here. Right there, the gentleman and the lady.
Hi, I'm Zachary Pakin, an assistant lecturer in international relations at the University of Kent in the United Kingdom. My question is sort of more fundamentally related to the overall posture and strategy of the European Union rather than limited to the Western Balkans specifically. And it has to do with this idea of encouraging countries to choose a European future, as if it's one or the other, but can't be both. And we talked a lot about during this panel this idea of Europe whole and free. Usually that phrase refers to the Charter of Paris of 1990, which was a Europe that included Russia. And Russia, in many ways, still does feel European and has been part of Europe for several centuries. And so the question is, should we be, not just in the case of the Western Balkans, but also in the case of countries like Ukraine, which are genuinely torn between East and West, is it a good idea for the European project to be encouraging these countries to choose that it has to be one or the other? Is that consistent that these countries have to choose one or the other? In fact, not what generated this security dilemma and the security conflict right now that we're seeing between Russia and the West right now.
Great, thanks.
We'll collect a few questions just because of the time and then we'll come back to the panel.
Hello, everybody. I'm Lolita Pesani, coming from North Macedonia, Minister for Foreign Affairs, and here with the new Security Leaders Program. Minister Szijjártó, thank you very much for your open support, and I fully agree with everything you say, not because I'm from North Macedonia, but because that's the reality, that's the fact. Well, integration of the Western Balkans in the EU is a win-win situation. I need to say that. Why? Because I want to make two points. We are, in the perception of the European Union, we are seen like a troublemakers in the region, these six guys who are making the troublemakers trouble. We don't need them. But guys, tell me one question. Is it true we don't have perfect rule of law, we don't have perfect democracy, so on and so on? But tell me one country in the European continent, one country in the EU, one country in the world who does have perfect system, who does have perfect functioning of the rule of law, who have perfect democracy. Is there anything? Is there any country like that in the world today? No. Yes, I have a question. Another question. We don't make a progress. I heard some things that we don't make a progress. Don't remember that 28 years ago, Western Balkans were one country, Yugoslavia. And we faced a war there. We know what is war recently. While European countries faced war like 200 years ago. And we did a lot of progress for 28 years ago. We are now NATO members, and so, I mean, we are not NATO members. Okay, question. Sorry. What do you think about 15th of October? Is Macedonia, North Macedonia, sorry, going to have a positive decision for opening the accession negotiations? And the second question will be, what will be the enlargement perspective of the new commission? Can we expect a positive policy of the new commission?
Great, thank you. Let me just take a couple more questions back, and then we could answer the question that gentleman right there.
Thank you. Well, my name is Stephen Meyer. I've been around Balkan stuff for 30 years. As a matter of fact, I was deputy chief of the CIA task force during the 90s. Still very much involved. Your assessment of the most upbeat, optimistic assessment I've heard in years. Until we got to Dan 3, nobody mentioned Bosnia, nobody's mentioned Kosovo. These are very critical issues. I just want to make a couple points which you can turn into questions. One, enlargement, the key to success, essentially, the economics, that's not so clear. I just did a paper for a Serbian news magazine. As I pointed out, almost all, or a great percentage of the trade in the Balkans is with other EU members. It's very, and they get a lot of pre-accession money. It's very difficult to see how it's going to improve membership. The numbers just aren't there. Secondly,
if you could just have a question.
These aren't questions. These are what the comments should be on. I'll raise that question mark at the end. So, the opening of chapters, you say, why? It's not that easy. There are some very, very difficult chapters. For Serbia, especially chapter 35 on Kosovo, you can't gloss over the importance of all those chapters. They've only opened two. Third, very quickly, the EU today, by the way, when you talk about 20 years ago, is a very, very different animal today than it was 20 years ago. It is not nearly as strong, it is not nearly as unified. The Balkans, major issues of war and peace, keep in mind, these had to do more with the imperial powers that came into the Balkans than it did with the Balkans. The Balkans may have been the powder keg, but they weren't the wick. And finally, I'm sorry, Dan, but Matthew Palmer's not the person. The problem, in my view, is he will go in and he will say, there is only one future for you. You can only go west to NATO, to the EU. You can't have a relationship with Iran, China, or Russia. And the other problem is, and this goes back to my days at CIA, we have really not been performed particularly well as mentors in the Balkans. Dick Holbrook never understood the full dimension of the ethnic issue, for example. So I'll just leave those comments.
With apologies to everyone else, I'll explain for 15 seconds if you can, just a quick, brief question.
Okay, I would like to give you all the speakers. All of you were really great, and I agree with your optimism for us. I didn't present myself as ambassador of Bosnia and Herzegovina in the Republic of Poland. So I would like to give just one more question. It is great that we have such speakers, but I think that much better panel would be if you would have someone from the Balkan. And in this case, I have the impression you are talking about us with our peace. So I'm here to correct it. I would like to say it in the name of Western Balkan area, whatever it means.
minister. I become listed you in Canada as ambassador, and you are really great people even there. What I want to say to express the opinion of ordinary people from Bosnia and Herzegovina, which you mentioned as a very critical point, let's say, like that, within the Balkan area. I was a pretty young woman or person when we started to speak about the European Union. Now I'm in mid-age and I hope that I will not be old person while we become the member of the EU. That is our impression then. So I'm asking now, because we insist on questions, what is the problem? Because all speakers thought we need Western Balkan area within the European Union, and what is the problem from your side? And one thing more about the special representative of US and the Western Balkan, how we watch it. You know, we are asking, is it good because US started to be interested in again after the situation, or it is not good because we didn't succeed to solve the problem so many years? One final sentence, because we have the special representative of the European Union and still have special representative of the international community. So three of them are. Thank you.
We started through this late for well, hopefully, and a couple minutes late as well, but if you could just respond to any of the questions that you want, given the limitations of time and the way that you will come to.
Very shortly, when it comes to Serbia, I absolutely disagree with putting this issue as a precondition to the story. We should leave it as a last point. And we should go through all the points of negotiation. Hopefully, as we go through those points, somehow this issue, I mean, between some of the possible would be resolved. But putting that as a precondition to solve it and then come to the other points, I think it's very, very unfair and shouldn't be. Shouldn't be done. When it comes to the 15th of October meeting, you know, I was very hopeful before the last meeting of the General Affairs Council as well. And everybody was speaking in favor of it, and even the representative of a big member state was speaking in favor of starting negotiations there on the meeting, and then after speaking, thinking this is not so true. You know, so I mean, this is really, really understandable. Unacceptable from my perspective, and I can't tell you what's going to be the position on the 15th of October, but I can tell you that we're going to be heavily in favor as we have been so far. And on the new European Commission, you see that our first commissioner was a Minister of Justice, was thrown out by the Socialist, Liberal and Green MEPs, because he was the one to make the rules and regulations in Hungary, which prevented ourselves to be invaded by illegal migrants. And the political revenge he was controlled. Now we'll have the current permanent representative of ours. We'll see whether there's going to be another political revenge or not. But if we are able to fulfill this position, you can be sure that we will be pushing even more than so far. But regarding the perfect democracy, you see that within the European Union we have these debates as well. The country where you are located now, where we are guests, and the country which I represent is in the focus. As somebody breaking rule of law, dictatorship, you know, whatever. But the real reason for that is that these are the two countries in the European Union where the ruling party can govern on its own. And this is hierarchy in the European Union portrayed as dictatorship, which is really, I mean, this position is a simulation of democracy, because these governments are governing on the basis of the will of the people, because these governments want their two-thirds or simple majority on election. And election is the expression of the will of the people, not a lottery. So I think that this mutual respect should be brought back to all our debates within the European Union and beyond. Because if we don't have mutual respect, if we only stigmatize each other, if we only lecture the other, then it will be nowhere regarding within the European Union or beyond. So I think that mutual respect should be brought back to the European Union. Hypocrisy, political correctness, and double standards should be left behind. And then I think we will be more successful on all of our policies. And when it comes to relationship to Russia, you know, many times we Hungarians are bad, are being spies of Putin, you know, we are customers. Look at the figures. Look at Serbian passengers. Increased by 41% in the last 2 years. Jordan the Russian trade increased by 20% in the last 2 years. Look at Hungary. We lost $8 billion of export opportunities. Look at the pipeline being built by the biggest Western European energy companies between Russia and Germany. Look at the number of high-level meetings between the Western Europeans and the Russians. Look at the big businesses they make under the surface. And look at how hypocritical they are when it comes to the Central European countries. And this is something which is unacceptable. In the European Union, it is not going for one way, Brexit, to go on. So it's going two ways. So it's going to be other countries. It should be like NATO European Union or European Union. It's the right way, I think. It's for the region, I believe, as I was young and today, it's the only way. And that, believe me, it's the 70 years of prosperity that we have today in the European Union or in the Europe. So we should carry that and we should continue that. I believe it's the only way this way in the European Union and NATO. I knew that. 15 October, I don't know, it's really here. And I think with Hungary and Slovenia, we are really supportive and we are doing all diplomatic efforts that the enlargement process, that we continue the enlargement process. At least we should reward countries that are showing, they are doing and following the European Union values, go on a democratic way. So it should be the countries that they are going that should be rewarded, and definitely it should be the clear signal for other countries that they should go the same way. And democracy and the rule of law, fighting the organized crime is the only way to go. Regarding the splitting of Europe, from the far away, yes, maybe yes. But in the meetings in Brussels, sometimes we are really unified. I think we are more unified today than we are many, many years ago. And I know other countries, I know the United States. I don't think that the United States today is more unified than 5 years ago. Just tell me if that's true. So it's not just the European Union there, that maybe we are split and that we have issues, but at least we are resolving that issues in democratic matters inside. However, it's not excuse that because we have issues and challenges regarding the Brexit, the MFF, the multi-annual financial framework and so on, it's not excuse that we don't continue with the enlargement process. So I think with the countries that we're talking today, the Europe will be just stronger. So of course it's a modern time and all countries, we have democratic countries, we have definitely challenges and so on. On the other side, to the other view, so we are doing our job, the European Union, I hope, and I really believe that we are doing our job and these some countries, but also you have to do your job. It's two-way process, it's not just one-way process, and it's two-way process, and you have to do the job that brings you to the democratic society, and it's two-way, just not looking to us, you are good, you know, it's always, you know, for fight, you need two people, so it's always on that way.
On the question of choice, we don't force anybody to make a choice. The Western Balkan countries have applied to become members of the European Union because they wish to. And of course, you can have relationships with China, we have with Russia, with Iran, but look, the membership of the European Union is not a relationship, it's a way of life. It comes with some conditions, so it's much more complex. Of course, our own member states have different kind of relationships with other powers in the world. That's the reality. But you ask what's the problem. The problem is that there is a certain process, a methodology that is going to stay here. We need a track record. We expect European legislation to be applied. I know it's a bit of a moving target because it's growing. I mean, by the time you join the European Union, there will be a new banking union and a couple of other things that we are now working on. But that's key, and that we are very clear on. I mean, the list of things to do is pretty obvious, and that includes exodus into the Kosovo problem, because we don't want to import any, can't import any of these legacy issues. We are not going to impose them.
But again, as we all know, the eagle a new mandate, the commission president-elect from the Lion, in their mission letters to the new high representative, Mr. Borrell, and the new commissioner for enlargement, also was very clear in their expectation to move the dialogue forward. So I hope it will start very soon, and we are ready, we are there to help. On the 15th of October, you know, we've done our utmost. We maintain our position that we expect green light for both countries. There are several opinions still, there are some ideas to add additional conditions to that. Let's see how it plays out. But we are going to this meeting in Luxembourg also with full determination to make it happen. Going to meet Commissioner Hahn on Friday, I'll relay to him the expectations also in this room, but also beyond. And only on the trade flows and trade integration, indeed, the Western Balkan countries are probably better linked with EU member states and among each other. It's not new. We were more or less in the same situation in the late 90s. We had to work on it. That's why we put forward this idea of a regional economic area for the Balkans. It's not a substitute for membership. And we are putting real money in that. I mean, one of our sort of flagships for the Balkans is connectivity. We've already set aside 900 million euros in investment for roads, telecommunication, railways, so just to bring about that integration, there is indeed no there. Anecdotically, whenever I travel from one country to another, I usually have to go back to Vienna because there are no direct flights. So there is still room for improvement.
I try to sound optimistic because, as an academic, could look at a glass and say it's not only half full, it's cracked and the water's leaking out. And if you touch it, you'll cut yourself and the glass will shatter. As a policymaker, our responsibility is to look at that cracked and miserable glass and figure out how to deal with it. That's what they paid us to do. Optimism is a different Australian professor now for anybody who's been paid to try to fix things rather than just describe it. Sometimes the optimism works out, sometimes it doesn't, but we're in Poland. 30 years ago, nobody thought that Poland or Hungary would end up as good as they ended up now. Nobody. So sometimes it works out. The EU process is hard and it should be hard. The conditions should be met. It's not a free ride. You know, the end of the road is EU membership, and there are conditions. And that's why some of the EU are skeptical, because of some of the fighting and different interpretations of what members' obligations are. But still, the EU is attractive for a lot of people in the region. I don't know what is meant by forcing the countries to choose. I must admit I react rather skeptically to that, because that's the Russian line with respect to Ukraine. And that's nonsense. The divisions between East and West of Ukraine, and Ukraine is a bridge. Yeah, all of that produced a massively corrupt, dysfunctional system, which Ukrainians themselves got rid of in 2014, after which Russia invaded their country. That's not Ukrainians being divided between East and West. That's Russia trying to keep its neighbors subordinate, subservient. Now, you might argue there's genuine pro-Russian feeling in Serbia or Republika Srpska. Maybe. And it's not for Brussels or Washington or anybody else to tell these people where they belong. They have to decide for themselves. But they need to decide based on a realistic prospect of membership in the EU and a realistic understanding of what it involves, because it isn't just a free ride. And so the West in general needs to be open about what's required, but open to good news. If they meet those conditions, they ought to be allowed in. I wish we could offer them the same deal we offer the West in general, offer the Poles, Czechoslovaks, Hungarians in the 90s. Okay, we can't. We're less united, we're less care of ourselves and the Russians are more aggressive. All right, so that's reality. What do we do? Do we give up? Do we tell the Balkans, the people of old Yugoslavia, you're on your own? Sorry, no shit. No. What do you want? But too bad. And too bad? We need to pull ourselves together and do the best we can. You know, honestly, as you know, it would be, I think the Serbs who are trying to think through their future ought to go to Kiev and visit a Pravoslavian country whose language they can pretty much understand and ask them what it's like living, you know, with the Russians and where that we're trying to accommodate themselves with the East and West brought them. That ought to be their decision. It's not ours, and it certainly ought not to be Vladimir Putin's.
Well, that was, I think we're out of time, but we could easily have gone for